All right, so I'm Ryan, otherwise known as The Man Is Music, and it's probably been about 3 or 4 months since my last video, which was the Tunes Tag for 2023, and probably even longer for my my last recent jazz vinyl finds. So that's what I'm gonna do today. I got a pretty decent stack here, a lot of heavy hitters that I've picked up throughout the past couple months, some that I never thought that I'd obtain, and then I have some stories to go along with some of them too as well. So I'm gonna start backwards through the alphabet, starting with Tina Brooks' True Blue. This is a 33 RPM Music Matters pressing. I made this purchase probably about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, and I've definitely made a lot of purchases like that, you know, midnight, early in the morning, around that time. But this is one that I definitely don't regret. Legendary album. It's almost impossible to get in original form. Especially because, you know, there was no United Artists pressing. It was just that original mono and then the DMM Direct Metal Mastering pressing that came out in like the late 80s or early 90s, maybe late 90s too as well. But this is just a phenomenal album. I mean, the cover just, it brings you in so much. I mean, it's the iconic Blue Note sound here, the iconic, you know, Blue Note look for this cover. Duke Jordan, Freddie Hubbard, like I said, Tina Brooks, Sam Jones, and Art Taylor. Just a legendary album. I probably would put this side by side with Blue Train. It's just, it sounds that good, both the music and the quality of this pressing. So my next one is going to be Terry Plumeri, if I pronounce his last name correct. I'm not sure, but this is He Who Lives in Many Places. This is a sealed copy. I haven't opened this yet. I haven't had much time. I've been playing a lot of CDs lately. I have a Johnny Mercer CD in my stereo system right now. Been playing a lot of Johnny Mercer, but not too many jazz records besides a few of these that I'm going to show in this video. But I bought this album because it has Herbie Hancock on it. And then also, like I said, it was sealed. So, you know, it was a definite, you know, buy, because I seen it on eBay for I think it was like around $20, and you know, that's a perfect price for this, especially when you're getting it in near mint condition. Although I'm not sure, you know, if this is warped or anything. I'll definitely open it up and check that out here soon. So definitely glad that I picked this up. And then my next one is a huge heavy hitter that I've been looking for forever, since I've been collecting Way Out West original mono near mint. I found this at a shop in Wilmington, North Carolina. I'm not going to name the shop because I'm going to go back there pretty soon. And I've definitely found a couple deals there last month when I went. So, like I said, this is the original mono with the red text. So I practically have my, you know, my favorite contemporary albums. I got Art Pepper's with the rhythm section, and then I got Way Out West, which I have an OJC of, and I hesitated on getting that box set that came out with alternate takes, as well as the, there's another one that came out with for this that was some like special reissue. But just so glad to have this. I wasn't really keen on buying one on eBay, just given the fact that the grading and, you know, spending that high cost, you know, sometimes it'll go up to $300. And I knew it was an accessible album. It's not like some of the other albums that I've gotten, like Wilbur Hardin's couple albums on Savoy, or, you know, some ridiculous rare stuff. This, it's a common record, it's just very expensive. So anyway, this is a near mint original copy. I mean, you can see how glossy that is. It looks perfect. There's probably like one hairline on it. No noise at all. I mean, the quality on contemporary's records, I think they're one of the best out of all the jazz labels back then, but I don't really hear it talked about a lot. I hear their stereo albums talked about, and that'll lead me into my next record here, but really glad to get Way Out West finally, after, you know, searching for it forever. And, you know, I was expecting to get it really early on in my collecting, just because I knew it was a common record, but I think it was like, it's been like 3 or 4 years since I started collecting, and that was one of the first records I've gotten. So anyway, my next record is a stereo copy of Sonny Rollins and the Contemporary Leaders. on Contemporary, of course, but this is the Black Label, so it's a second stereo pressing. I've heard a lot of people talk about the lineup on here, and they say that they're not, like, they're not a fan of it or anything, but when I put this on, because, granted, I never really played this prior to picking this up. This is one of those albums that I was just hoping to get on vinyl and have that, you know, that first experience with the listening, but I heard a lot of people say that they didn't really like the lineup here, because you have Barney Kessel, Hampton Hawes, Leroy Vinegar, and then Shelly Mann, however you pronounce his last name. But personally, I think this is one of the best lineups I've seen. Maybe not like one that catches your eye or anything, but it's definitely, you know, it's a good sounding record. I think Barney Kessel does an amazing job, you know, just combining with Sonny Rollins, especially on the first song, which was I found a new baby, or maybe it was on the other side. I think it was on the other side. Yeah, I've told Every Little Star. I think that was the one that I was just like, I couldn't see how people thought this lineup wasn't that good, because this is just a great, great record. And I got this for a decent deal, $50. Near mint condition. I got this the same place, the store in Wilmington that I went to, that I got Way Out West for, which I spent $200 for. And I personally think that's a great deal, considering it was near mint vinyl condition, and then I'd say about VG plus condition on the jacket. And usually I think I would see those go for around a little over $300, if you're lucky around $200. So anyway, my next one is Ray Bryant, Alone with the Blues. This is a record on New Jazz. This is a VG Plus copy that I picked up a couple months ago. I think I got it off of Discogs for like $50 or something like that. It's an amazing, amazing record. It was actually one of the cheaper New Jazz albums that I've found looking through the discography for New Jazz. And I don't understand how, because this is definitely one of my favorite New Jazz albums. The title suggests, this is Ray Bryant solo on piano. And I only know of a few other albums like that. You know, you have Red Garland solo, I think Oscar Peterson solo that was on Verve. I think he actually plays a lot solo. And there's one more that I can't think of. Maybe it was Jakai Bird. Can't think of it off the top of my head. There's got to be a few more. But really glad that I could get that, especially, you know, it being in that condition, original, and also that cheap. So anyway, my next one here is an OJC of Roots, which is actually a really rare prestige album. There was two, there's three copies of it, maybe four if you count the CD, but you have this OJC, and then you have the original, which was on the Bergen Fireworks label, and then there was a second pressing, which was on the New Jazz label. So it was made around that time that they made, you know, they had that conversion from this looking label to New Jazz. So, you know, I'm just in love with this album. I did a video on Idris Selman probably over half a year ago, maybe. And I was just in love with his playing. He's one of my favorite trumpeters of all time. And he's actually on this record here that I also mentioned in the video that I did. You got a crazy, crazy lineup on here, which is to be expected because this is a prestige all-stars album. But you have Frank Rehak, Jimmy Cleveland, Pepper Adams, Cecil Payne, who I think does a great job on this record. Tommy Flanagan, Bill Evans, Doug Watkins, Lewis Hayes, Elvin Jones, and it's prestige 8202. So just really love that record. And then here's my next one. McCoy Tyner plays Ellington. I didn't have this in a previous video. For some reason I thought I did, but I guess I didn't. But I picked this up off of a seller in Australia, and he shipped it over here, and he shipped the record inside the jacket, which I just thought was kind of stupid because, you know, the seam splits can still happen, and they did on the end there, you can see. I don't know if you can see that well, maybe. There we go. You can kind of see that split. And it kind of had me pissed off because, you know, it's common sense to know, you know, it can still go through the center on this gatefold. So, But either way, I guess I'm really happy with this because this is an original stereo pressing. I think I would have liked to have, original mono or maybe like a promo or something like that, just because this is like really obtainable. And I kind of like to challenge myself when it comes to certain discographies, especially McCoy Tyner's, because with McCoy Tyner, I like to get promos. I like to, you know, get some of those more hard to obtain records when, you know, within reason. Because, I mean, some of McCoy Tyner's records are almost impossible to get. So anyway, my next one is Lem Winchester with the Ramsey Lewis Trio. I picked this up because there's a song on here by Robert Lowry that it's called A Message from Boise, which was his nickname. But Robert Lowry is Clifford Brown's teacher. He recorded him on one of these albums that I have in here, which is a Clifford Brown festival. And it had like a acetate of his first recording that was recorded by Robert Lowry. And Robert Lowry was also his high school music teacher. So, you know, I just had to get this and kind of, you know, round out my collection for Robert Lowry and then also Clifford Brown. Because I think it's instrumental to have stuff like this, especially for an artist that was born in the same state as I was. Clifford Brown was probably born around 35 minutes to an hour, probably. I'd say about 35 minutes, 40 minutes away from me. So I just had to have that. And that's on Argo. And I got that for about like $4. And it's kind of rare from what I've seen on Discogs and on eBay. It's definitely hard to get in good condition at least. So my next one is Search for the New Land by Lee Morgan. Legendary album. I've talked about this so much. I have a 2015 75th anniversary series reissue. But this is a second mono pressing without the P. I'd say about VG to VG plus because there's one mark on here that kind of makes some noise. But besides that, very glossy. You can see it's still in the shrink, but it does have a top seam split. Really happy to get this. I got this for like $14 or something. I sent somebody a best offer and with shipping, I think it was like $14. So this is just a crazy deal. I would love to have a Plastolite P pressing, but that's probably, you know, way off in terms of, you know, collecting and, you know, seeing something like that for a good deal, at least for me to jump on it. So my next one is Kenny Dorham Jazz Contrasts. This is a second pressing on the blue label. There was no, you know, third era. I mean, I forget what they call it, but this is like that. The one that's, it's got the smaller deep groove, aside from the Riverside reissues that, and pressings that they had in like 62 and I think like 60 through, probably through like 64, somewhere around there. I think this is like 59 or 60, but I was really glad to get this because I had this on my want list, at least like the top records that I wanted this year. So it's not too great of quality. Probably like maybe G plus. The seller advertised it as VG, but I would definitely say G plus. It's got tape on all the seams except the outer. But I'm just kind of glad to get it because this is one of my favorite records. I would have just, you know, I just wanted something close to the original. And the reason I love this album is because you have Clifford Brown's recording, LaRue, yeah, that's how you pronounce it, which he wrote for his wife, and I think he played it on the beach. I can't remember if he proposed to his wife that night that he played this on the beach for her or not, but I know that he did play it on the beach for her, and he wrote the composition but never recorded it, sadly. And Kenny Dorham and like a few other artists are the only ones that have recorded it, but at least back then it was just Kenny Dorham. But within like the past like 20 years, there's been a few artists that have recorded the composition, and I think they've done a phenomenal job. Anytime anybody plays that song, I think it's amazing. The composition is just so powerful. The way the note hits you, it's a very romantic song. Definitely one of my favorites of all time, especially the ones that Clifford Brown wrote. So my next one is a Kenny Burrell acetate that he did for Milestone for the Duke Ellington, I think it was volume 2 or volume, maybe it was volume 1, I think it may have been volume, yeah, I think it was volume 1, but this was June 29th, 1976, you can see the Milestone sticker that they place on this cover, and then there's the acetate. It's a, you know, full-on acetate, nothing, you know, no, like, it's not like a test-pressing acetate or anything like, you know, like that. It's a real acetate that they used. There's actually a recording of this on YouTube from the seller that I got it from. He had recorded it and then posted it to YouTube. So I may link that in the video so everybody can go check that out, because I think this is a crazy good recording, because it has Duke Ellington's trombonist, who was a vocalist. I should have it on the top of my head, but I don't. But he recorded with Duke Ellington for a couple years, and he was his trombone and vocalist for the band. But he sings on both sides, which Lost in Meditation and then Prelude to a Kiss. One of these is unreleased, and then the other one is alternate take. So I just thought this was pretty cool. I had to have it because in the future, I want to complete my Kenny Burrell discography, and I think this is something that will definitely round it out when I, you know, when I get nearer to that. And then also to go with that one, I also have Blues, The Common Ground by Kenny Burrell on Verve. This is a MGM pressing, has the Van Gelder stamp and everything. I think I got this for like $10. Great deal, great record. The crazy thing about this one is the lineup. I mean, you have Ron Carter on here, Herbie Hancock and Grady Tate. And then you also have like a big band setup on a few of the songs. Don Sebesky was the arranger and conductor for the big band kind of environment here. Jimmy Cleveland, Don Butterfield, Jerome Richardson, and then again, Herbie Hancock and Ron Carter are also in that big band grouping. So my next one is huge, huge one for me. It's Little Johnny C, Johnny Cole's. This is a original stereo pressing. No deep groove because, of course, the original mono had deep groove. I think it was on side one, but not on side two. And the stereo pressing does not have a... it never had a deep groove for the first pressing. So I was really glad to get this. Just a great, great record. One that I never thought that I would obtain. I thought I was gonna get the classic series and, you know, just be done with it because it's very expensive. And definitely one of the hardest to get, I would say, you know, for the stereos, just because most of the ones that you see on eBay, they're like that 70s, I think it was the West Coast label. It's like 71, 72, 72-ish pressings around there. So I was really glad to get that. And then my next one is Crazy Baby, the Incredible Jimmy Smith. I think this is a trio. This is actually, yeah, it's a trio, but it's not in too great a condition. I would say it's the second pressing because it has that different colored font. The first pressing had the yellow font, but this has the white font. But then it has the first pressing disc. So, glad to have this in my collection. I definitely want to upgrade it though, because it's not in too great condition. So my next one is another heavy hitter, Silver's Blue. This is a promo copy that I picked up for like $45, which is by far one of the best deals I've ever gotten on a record. Within the past year, I've definitely gotten a lot better, I guess you could say. You know, Hank Mobley and stuff like that. But this is one that I was really happy to get because it's recorded in 1956. And I think it was like A few days after, or a few days before, Mobley's Message was recorded, which is one of my favorite records of all time. One of my most expensive in my collection, and definitely one that I hold real close in my collection in terms of, things that I've found out in the wild and that kind of, put me into this whole jazz collecting craze. So this is a VG Plus copy. I'd actually say excellent. I've played it a few times and it sounds phenomenal. Maybe just a few hairlines here and there, but it looks perfect. I mean, you can see how glossy that is. This is definitely one I'm really proud to have. There's a reissue that was on Epic with another picture of Horace Silver that I thought I was going to probably get, but I seen this go up and I jumped on it. It had a best offer and I didn't even put the offer in. I just bought it out. So my next one is Idle Moments by Grant Green. I think I got this on a best offer. I think I sent like $10 less and I got it for around $30. This record goes for a lot these days. Even this pressing and pressings after this, like, the blue label with the black B, that still goes for a lot. And this I actually got, like I said, for $35, so cheaper than, the usual going rate. And it's got the Van Gelder stamp. It's in VG Plus condition, but the jacket kind of has some mildew staining. Maybe you could say mold. I'm not sure, but I know that the inside it doesn't look too great. So anyway, I'm just like really happy to have this because, they got the classic series out, and then you also had the option of spending upwards of $100, maybe $80 if you went for a Black Bee pressing. But since this is a VG Plus copy, I would say that $35 is a great deal for it. And then here's my Donald Byrd, A New Perspective. This is an original mono copy in near mint condition. You can see the cover looks perfect. The only thing about it is there's a stamp from the previous owner, but you can just see how sharp that looks. It's got the original sleeve in here. I'm not gonna take it out or anything, but the sleeve is perfect, no staining. The collector who owned this also owned Way Out West. So, I knew it was in original condition when I, looked at it, and I didn't even really take the record out because I seen Howard Loving on it. And that's the guy who owned him before. So the disc, like I said, is near mint. You can see how glossy it is. It's probably only been played a couple times. The only thing I see wrong with it is maybe like some spindle marks. But I mean, just look at that. Deep Groove side one. Lovely record. I have a second or third pressing. I would say third pressing because it doesn't have the plastic P, no Deep Groove, of course, and it's not in too great a condition. So this was a definite, easy decision when I seen this for $80 in the same place that I got Way Out West and Sonny Rollins and the Contemporary Leaders. So then here's my second to last, Soul Time, Bobby Timmons. Not too much to say about this record. It's great. Definitely one that I spin a lot, but nothing too crazy here in terms of the music. It's not like, venturing further out or, setting a new milestone in jazz. It's just a great lineup here. Blue Mitchell's on here. I think he's probably one of my favorite trumpeters when it comes to the sound that he's producing on this album. It's like that mid-60s sound that he had. And I think he was ahead of his time in terms of, the early 60s, because he kind of kept the same sound that he had. And that's one of the things that I love about Blue Mitchell and all of his records, because it's his own style. Nobody's changing him. And you can definitely, just hearing his sound, it's him. So anyway, you got Bobby Timmons here, Art Blakey, like I said, Blue Mitchell, and then Sam Jones. Great record. This is my stereo copy, VG Plus condition. I got this for a deal. I think it was like $20-some. So then my last record is Cirrus, if that's how you pronounce it, by Bobby Hutcherson. Near mint vinyl, first pressing or second pressing, depending on, the pressing plant that you would identify with. But Black B, no Van Gelder stamp because I don't think there was ever one for this record. But really, really glad to get this because I listened to this a lot on Spotify on repeat, and this is one that I had on my want list probably for about like 2 years now. There's probably a lot of other people who've had it on there longer, but I was just really happy to get this. And I also had this in the, I got this in the same place that I got Sonny Rollins and the Donald Byrd record. So I was just really glad to pick this up in the same place. A lot of grails, I would say, that I got from that, just that one store that I'll leave unnamed, just for the fact that I'll go back there probably within the next couple weeks or maybe a month. But it is quite the trip, you know, to fly down there and ship them back, because I can't take them on the plane, especially with the amount that I'm buying from there. If they keep up the, you know, the jazz, the influx of jazz records through there. So anyway, that's my recent jazz vinyl finds. I'm not sure what number this is. It's probably like 4 or 5, but I'm not sure when I'll get my next video up. I do know that I want to aim for Coltrane's, the date that his new album comes out with Eric Dolphy, which I've pre-ordered on the orange vinyl for Impulse. I want to try and put his whole discography up on YouTube here and go over everything that he's done. All like 200 and some releases and everything like that. I just want to go through it all, cover everything. I'm probably 98% complete with his discography. And, you know, like I said, once that album comes out that, you know, with Eric Dolphy on Impulse, that'll just be, you know, one of the celebrations that I'll kind of add to that by showing all my John Coltrane releases, and then going over the history, everything like that. So anyway, thank everybody for watching my video, and I'll link my Tunes Tag video in here, and then I also was gonna link something else. I'll rewatch my video and then figure out what that was. So anyway, thank you.